Aye. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Glad you're here. It's a little bit different today. And I was walking in, I was looking at Brother Ron. I said, you know, it looks like chaos today, but we really know what we're doing. I think. We're glad you're here. And of those of you who are watching on live stream, we're going to be welcoming you in and out today because there's going to be a lot of different things going on. So if you'd please take out your bulletin, there's some things I need to highlight for you. And then later on, after we sing a little bit, I'll explain to you how we're going to do this morning as far as moving around and where the refreshments and things are. Inside of your bulletin, you'll notice that if you're visiting with us today, there's a welcome portion. If you would please look at that, remove it from the bulletin and then fill it out and then drop it in the offering plates on your way out this morning. We would appreciate that. Now, here's the announcements that are going to be really, really important because it's going to be sign-up time here in the next couple of weeks. So the first thing is the youth are going to have a lockout party. And you to bring a tent, a blanket, sleeping bag, and pray for warm weather. This is going to be on Saturday, January 30th. It begins at, the 29th on Friday night at 6 p.m. And then it'll conclude around Saturday morning when everybody wakes up. So if you have any questions, get Brother Matt and Miss Alyssa. And their little kiosk is over here in the corner. So parents, grandparents, you may want to run by there and pick up some information about that as well. And then we have some Bible studies that are forthcoming. We have the Grief Share. Let me back up. Grief Share, February 3rd, it starts on a Wednesday night at 6 p.m. It'll be back in the Missions Hall. You'll have Melanie Scoggin and Kay Cochran back there. And they also have a table that's in here today. And then also we have a ladies' Bible study, Jesus and Women. It starts on Wednesday night, the 10th. It goes through May 12th. It'll also be back in our Missions Hall. And see my wife Sandy, and she'll help you with that. And then we have Elijah. That's going to be February 12th. It's on a Friday. It's at 10 a.m. on Friday mornings. It's another Bible study that you can be a part of. So please be aware of these things. It is so important that you can get as much teaching as you can. Now, listen to me real quick. Why are Bible studies important? Because you think about how many hours a week do we watch other things? TV, computer, iPhone. And then you say, how many hours do I spend reading God's Word? How many hours do I spend worshiping with other believers? So if you look at that balance, we need more of this than we need more of that. Because whatever controls your mind, that's where we go. That's where we live. And so it is paramount in the days that we're living in. I mean, folks, this was 1910. It's still paramount that we spend as much time as we can around the things of God, around the Word of God, and around the people of God, because that's where we get our strength from. That's where we get our nourishment. That's what this whole thing is about today. You know, and if I pray that everybody got their piece of the puzzle. Did you get your piece of the puzzle? Where do you fit? This is important, and we're going to be talking about that. We want everyone to be and have a part of the ministry of what's going on here at Crescent Beach Baptist Church. Okay? All right. So let's have a word of prayer and ask God to bless what we're going to be doing here today in His favor upon us. So let's pray together. Our Father, we come in Jesus' name, the greatest name, Lord, that's ever been uttered by man. The name that just seems to, for those of us who know You personally, it not only warms our hearts, it brings us comfort. It gives us incredible strength. It calms us. And I heard John MacArthur say many years ago, there's a lot of things I do not know and understand, but I know that You do, God, and that's where I'll rest. And Lord, that's where we want to rest this morning. A lot of things in life that we just do not understand. Things happen, heartaches, Lord, tragedies, and it just sort of leaves us hanging, and we're not sure what to think or do. And then we hear the name of Jesus, and then it all begins to, not so much to make sense where all the dots are connected, but it makes sense because we know that He's in control. No one has usurped His throne this morning in heaven. No one has taken His place. No one can ever take His place. And we have the promises of God that He will never leave us nor forsake us. He promises that He'll walk through us through the valley of the shadow of death. He promises us that to be absent from the body is to be with Him immediately, faster than a blinking of an eye. So our Father, we come this morning and we give you praise and honor and glory for the Lamb of God who has taken away the sin of the world. And God, you have called us the church. You saved us as individuals. And then, Lord, you want us to be incorporated into the body of Christ called the church. And you have given us, Lord, the incredible privilege to share the good news that Jesus saves, Jesus forgives, Jesus doesn't keep score. He is real. It works. Father, I pray today that as we fellowship, as we sing, as we gather around your word, as we just worship together, I pray today that you would be well pleased with what you see going on in this room in the hearts of your people today. For we ask and pray all these things in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Mr. King?
Well, good morning. We are glad that you're here. Let's join together our voices as we stand and sing. Who are we as Christians? Christ ones. When we gather together, that's a special, special function that he's ordained us and asked us to do, is to gather. And so one of those things that we do according to the Psalms and even into the New Testament is that we sing. So let's sing together this morning. Come, Christians, ready?
Come, Christians, join to sing. Alleluia, amen. Loud praise to Christ our King. Alleluia, amen. Let all with heart and voice before his throne rejoice. Praise is his choice. Alleluia.
prayer that that would be what you echo, that that's where you are today, that you have Jesus, and how could I want more than that? Because you've tasted, you've tested, and you have seen that he is faithful and true to his word. One of the things I was trying to do is we're looking at the church and the role and the purpose of the church. When we gather together, there are certain things that we do, and one of those functions is we study. One of those functions is, and you may wonder, how do you know this? Well, Acts 2, verse 42, speaking of the apostles, and the pattern that they led was they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and in fellowship, and in the breaking of bread, and in prayers. Reminds us of the task that we have in front of us, and that's just as we're Christians, let alone when we're gathered. And so my hope is that we would understand that, and then also we would understand that that message is to be taken from this place to our community. It's right outside our door. It could be in your community. It could be that it's outside of St. Augustine. It could be that it's outside of Florida. It could be that it's outside of the United States. So we have things, we have opportunities for you to get involved in those things. We will help train you, help teach you how to share your faith. And we will help you take that to the uttermost part of the world. That's the song that we're singing next. O church, arise and put your armor on. Hear the call of Christ, our captain. We have a task to take this message outside of these four walls.
They are strong. getting through. We do. Do you wish that you could see it all made new? We do.
Everybody sing.
Is all creation growing? It is. Is a new creation coming? It is. Is the glory of the Lord light within our midst? It is. Is it good that we remind ourselves of this?
Hearts, we bow our minds, we bow our spirits. The song we just sung speaks of what goes on in the throne room even now. The elders gather around the throne and they cry, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." Father, through all of the plans that we make and the beautiful displays, if we are nothing but whitewashed, they are nothing. The ministries that we have here, the things that go from this place, if you are not in the center of it, if you're not in the center of us. Is it safe to say we do it for nothing? Help us to remember that you called us with an everlasting love. You provided the salvation for us through Jesus Christ, his shed blood on the cross, his resurrection. And then you sent the Spirit to dwell within each and every one of us who are willing to respond to that call and to put our faith and trust in you. We have the power of God in each of us. Father, make that real this morning. Challenge our hearts. When we ask, where do we fit? It's not just really here at Crescent Beach. It's where do we fit with you and your plans? So, Father, move in our hearts this morning. Remind us clearly that you've called us for a purpose. It's in Jesus' name I ask. Amen.
You may be seated, church. Give you some instructions. You can notice the markings on the floor. That's sort of the pattern we like you to take so we don't have traffic jams. Through those doors over here to your right down the hallway, there'll be some refreshments. I think there's some donuts and some hot chocolate and coffee and things and water. So that'll be made available for you. I want you to go and spend time at each table and ask questions and just see what's going on here in your church body. And it is so, so important. And again, be praying as you go and you ask the question, where do I fit, Lord? Where would you have me to serve? Now you say, well, I'm already serving. Where would he have you to serve next? There's something I learned a long time ago in ministry. If I start something as the pastor, and once it gets up and running, I need to walk away from that. I'll give you an example. When I went to North Carolina, we had they had a men's breakfast once a month, and they did it on Sunday morning, and they did it like at 8 o'clock, and it just kind of interfered with a lot of stuff. And so when I got there, they said, what do you want to do about this? I said, why don't we do it on Saturday morning, and that way we can do it at 8 o'clock. And I said, we won't interfere with a lot of things going on. And there was two guys that said, well, we've always done it, two guys, and we like Sunday morning. I said, well, if you come on Saturday morning, you probably have a lot more help. All right, we'll try it. It was a big hit. We had a great time, had more people there than they ever had. And then after about a year or so, they said, you know, we're getting kind of tired, preacher. What do you think? I said, why don't we give it away and let somebody else do it? Well, you know what happened. Well, I don't know. They may not do it like we always did it. I said, they'd probably be better then. And so they did, they gave it away, and you know what? It's amazing. God blessed it. I don't know how it happened because these two guys had to let go of it, and there's lots of stuff going on. So what I'm learning is this. Once you start something, you need to give it away, and then you go and start something else and let somebody else do that. And you know what? It starts growing, and the church is stronger, and the church is better. So it may be now time for you to move on and get involved in something else. So where do you fit now is the question. When we start saying we've always done it this way, we don't want to change it, we want to leave it the way it is, then maybe it's time to move on just a little bit, okay? Every once in a while, some things need to be tweaked. My barber does that once a month when he cuts my hair. Singular, okay? So keep that in mind. Y'all really enjoying that, aren't you, over here? Ignore these people. They're just, we feed them once in a while and they'll come back. But as you go around, fellowship, ask questions, and, did everybody get a keychain? Did everybody get one? All right. I want you to take it out and put it on your finger, and I want you to walk around with that and ask, okay, where do I fit? Where do I fit, Lord? Where do I fit? Okay? Because it's important. The reason why we're doing this, as Kevin's already mentioned, that is this is going to make our body stronger, and you'll hear it in the message in a few hours. But it's going to make everything a lot better, okay? Everything a lot better. It's going to make us stronger as a church. And why? Because we have no idea what God's going to do with us and in us and through us in the coming year. Amen? All right. So let's pray. And then after a little bit, we'll call you back together. And then we'll get ready to continue on with our time together today. So now let me pray. Move around. Check all the tables out. There's refreshments over here. Please visit all the tables. Okay? So let's pray together. Our Father, in Jesus' name we come. And Lord, now's the time for fellowship, yes, but Lord, also I pray the Spirit of God would move on the hearts of every person in this place. And Lord, they would ask the question, where do I fit? What can I be involved in? Lord, it can be a prayer ministry, it can be Bible studies, it could be missions, dining with dignity, grief share, Lord, it could be with cultural impact. Lord, there's lots of stuff here, Lord. And God, you put all this here for us, and we're part of this body, so Lord, that means that we need to be involved here. So now, Lord, I pray your blessing and your favor on us in this time of fellowship. Bless the refreshments we're about to have. Thank you for all the hands and all the time and effort that's gone into putting this on today. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. All right, circulate.
Yeah.
Amen? Amen. 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 Pray for Kevin and the girls and Cameron. They're heading back to Ohio this afternoon. And I understand it's a little warm up there. So
snowing.
Snowing warm. So pray for them. I'll have traveling grace and mercy this afternoon. If you'd open your Bibles and turn to Psalm 127, verses 1 and 2, and then to Ephesians chapter 4. So two places, Psalm 127 and then Ephesians chapter 4. And as you find your place, would you please stand with me so that together we might honor the reading of God's Word this morning. Psalm 127 and then Ephesians 4. We'll stand together and honor God's Word. And the children can slip out. All right. Psalm 127, verses 1 and 2. The Bible says, "Unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain who build it. Unless the Lord guards the city, the watchman stays awake in vain. It is vain for you to rise up early, to sit up late, to eat the bread of sorrows, for so he gives his beloved sleep." And then Ephesians chapter 4, verse 7. Ephesians 4, verse 7. "But to each one of us grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift." Down to verse 11. "And he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, for the equipping of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we should no longer be children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the trickery of men and the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up in all things unto him who is the head, Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love." May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word. Let's pause just for a moment. Our Father, we ask for your divine inspiration this morning. We ask for that divine illumination, Lord, that we need in our hearts and minds so that we can grasp these truths. And Lord, not just to understand it, maybe be able to even share it or teach it, but Lord, make the personal application to my own life. Where do I fit in the body of Christ? You've given each one of us a grace gift. And Lord, how do I know what that is? And what do I do with it? How do I find my place? Spirit of God, be our teacher. Be our great reminder today. Thank you for this time that we can gather here, Lord. Now I pray as we look into your word, speak to each of our hearts and minds. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. I was reading last week in one of the blogs that I look at. A man by the name of Leo Roston said this. He says, "I cannot believe that the purpose of life is to be happy. I cannot believe that the purpose of life is to be happy. I think the purpose of life is to be useful, to be responsible, to be compassionate. It is above all to matter, to count, to stand for something, to have made some difference that you lived at all." When you think about what we're looking at today, Psalm 127, it was written by Solomon, the son of David. Solomon had been given the task of building the temple in Jerusalem. And so this psalm, especially, you know, the verses 1 and 2, is called the Builder's Psalm. Solomon's best-known words are found in Ecclesiastes 1:2, and when I read it, you'll understand. He says, "Vanities of vanities, says the preacher, vanity of vanities, all is vanity." Now, what does vanity mean? Meaningless. Utterly meaningless. Vanity of vanities, all is vanity. When you go back to Psalm 127, verses 1 and 2, the word vain is mentioned three times in just these two verses. And for emphasis, I want to read it again. "Unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain who build it." It's meaningless. "Unless the Lord guards the city, the watchman stays awake in vain. It is vain for you to rise up early, to sit up late, to eat the bread of sorrows, for so he gives his beloved sleep. If we will trust God and do it literally his way, then life will not be meaningless." That's his point. There's a motto that appears on the crest of the city of Edinburgh, Scotland, and is affixed to all the city's official documents. The motto says this, and it's in Latin, "Nisi Dominus Frusta." It comes from the first words of Psalm 127, and it means, "Without the Lord, frustration." Without the Lord, frustration. The American statesman, Benjamin Franklin, was not a Christian. He was a deist. Though he appreciated Christians, he thought well of George Whitefield, and on Sunday afternoons, Franklin would find out where the pastor, the preacher, was speaking, George Whitefield, and he would go because he had been kicked out of most of the churches in New England, and so he would go out and have these open-air revivals. And he would stand on a stump in an open field, and he would preach for a couple of hours, and Benjamin Franklin was just, he just thought he was a fine speaker. But Franklin understood the futility of work without God, even though he was a deist, and he expressed it well in his speech to the convention for forming a constitution for the United States. I'm going to read a part of this. Listen to what he says. "In the beginning of the contest with Britain," he writes, "when we were sensible of danger, we had daily prayers in this room." Now they're in Philadelphia. "We had daily prayers in this room for divine protection. Our prayers, sir, were heard, and they were graciously answered. All of us who were engaged in the struggle must have observed frequent instances of a superintending providence. To that kind providence, we owe this opportunity of consulting in peace on the matters of establishing our future national felicity. And have we now forgotten this powerful friend? Or do we imagine that we no longer need his assistance? I have lived a long time." He was 81 years of age when he wrote this. "And the longer I live, the more convincing proof I see of this truth, that God governs in the affairs of men. And if a sparrow cannot fall to the ground without his notice, is it possible that an empire can rise without his aid? We have been assured, sir, in the sacred writings, that except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it." Now listen to what he says, this last sentence. "I firmly believe this, and I also believe that without his concurring aid, we shall proceed in this political building no better than the builders of Babel." It would be vanity for us to think that Crescent Beach Baptist Church would even dare think of not acknowledging God's blessing and favor upon us. These past 17 years that I've been here, and the last 15, almost 16 now that we have been on this property, it's almost like it's a blur. But yet God has done so much on our behalf, and I am convinced that this is only the tip of the iceberg. And the reason why I say that is because God doesn't just do anything just to have something done. He has a purpose behind everything that we do. He has a very purpose and the reason why we're all here today. You think about just looking around at the different ministries that this church is involved in. And I hope and pray that some of you are like, really? We're involved in doing this many things? And notice, we're involved in doing this many things. It's us as the bodies of Christ. That's why God has put us here. That's why he has sent you here. That's why he has prodded you to say, you need to get involved, you need to join, you need to become a member, you need to get plugged in, however you want to say it. It is so, so important. But back to Psalm 127 just for a moment. Let me give you a couple of bullet points. What the Lord builds, he maintains. Unless the Lord build the house, they build it in vain. What he builds, he maintains it. What man builds, no matter the effort, rise up early, stay up late, eat the bread of sorrow, frustration, it won't last. For so God gives his beloved sleep, rest, and peace. Why? Because this is his work. And without the Lord, there is frustration. Let's go to Chambers just for a moment. Oswald Chambers. He writes, do you understand that Jesus preached and taught anti-realization? Anti-realization. We focus on what God puts in us and we call that success. Jesus is after the exact opposite. If we are going to be like him, the measuring stick is not what we gain, but what we allow God to pass through us. It's called self-expenditure. God the Father does not make us into beautifully rounded grapes for others to admire, but so that he may squeeze the sweetness out of us. The squeezings are called influence. God is not into beauty pageants, but he is into pouring himself into the lives of folks who make up the body of Christ. Now our text this morning is in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 7 and then 11 through 16. And there's some that we're going to look at, and I'm going to look at some other verses in this chapter. But concerning the body of Christ, notice God's purpose. Go back with me to verse 7 just for a moment. But to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. So you have been given a gift. In salvation, he has given you a gift. It's called everlasting life. We call it salvation. You can call it redemption. But here it says, according to the measure of Christ's gift, each one of us has been given grace. Now, we know that we're saved by grace through faith. We understand that. I hope we do. And that it's not of works, lest any man should boast. But this grace that he's talking about is, and now look down in verse 11, and he himself, God himself, has given to the church some more gifts. To be apostles, prophets, evangelists, some pastor, teachers. That's the order. That's the instruction, if you please. That God has given those individuals to the church as a gift. Now, not to be facetious, but how many of you come in on Sunday morning and you look up here and you go, there's our gift from God? I didn't think so. I would just, we'll move on from that. They're probably saying, oh, man. Can we re-gift? No, we won't go there. We won't do that one. But listen to verse 16. I'm going to read it to you. I read it earlier, but listen to a translation, a Greek translation. This is from Kenneth Wiest. From whom all the body constantly being joined together and constantly being knit together, through every joint of supply, according to the operative energy put forth to the capacity of each part, makes for increased growth of the body in the building up of itself in the sphere of love. Now, when you read it like that in a Greek translation, you go, oh, there's more to that than just saying that what every joint supplies according to the effect of working by which everyone. So, number one, and this is God's purpose. God is constantly, we are constantly being fitted together. He's tweaking us. He's molding us. That's why today when I said, you know, you go around us, and if you've been in one ministry for a long time, maybe it's time for you to go and be involved in another one or maybe start a new ministry. Constantly being fitted together. Constantly being knitted together. Notice it says in verse 16, from whom the whole body joined and knit together. Joined and knit together. There's a sewing factor. There's a serving factor here. Now, here's what's amazing, and this is where some of us get a little bit nervous. God is doing the sewing. He's doing the knitting. He's putting it together. He's put together this body of Christ called Crescent Beach. He has put us here. You have talents I do not have. I have talents that you do not have. But we both have grace. And so God has put us together, and he's knitting us together. And we're joined, and we are compacted. That picture is that he's pressing us together so that we're not individuals. We are one. That's the whole picture here. The contributing factor, look in verse 16, what every joint supplies. Let me go back to the Greek translation. Being knit together through every joint of supply according to the operative energy put forth to the capacity of each part. In other words, you're not just chipping in, you're all in. You are committed. Your heart is here. And remember, all of this is wrapped up and bound up in grace. Go back with me in verse 1 of chapter 4. Paul writes, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called. Walk worthy of the calling. Now, who called you? The Lord Jesus did. Now, the worthiness, the characteristics of this calling is in verses 2 and 3. With all lowliness, humility, and gentleness, with long-suffering, patience, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. That's God's purpose. That's part of those grace gifts that he has given us. That's the grace he gives us in salvation. But then in verse 7 he says, but to each one of you is given a grace gift. In other words, this is something that God says, all right, I can look down and I can see in the future that you're going to be a part of Crescent Beach Baptist Church, and I have gifted you, and that will be a perfect fit for you right there in that church, because the church needs you and you need the church. That's how it works. The purpose of God is very simple. It's called a contributing factor. You cannot contribute unless you have been joined or fitted into the body. We have to ask the question, is my contribution making an increase or a decrease in the body? Am I helping or am I hurting the body? Jesus gave himself for us as an offering. You're in Ephesians. Look in chapter 5. Look in verse 25. Ephesians 5, verse 25. Here we have, it's a picture of the sanctification of the church. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her. Now, we know that Jesus died on the cross. We understand about our sin debt being eradicated. We understand that. But yet, the picture is that Jesus gave himself for the church. And because when we ask Christ to save us, the Bible says he comes and he dwells in us. And so what should be the next question? I am to give myself for the church and to the church. Now, that doesn't mean you got to be down here 7 days a week. No, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about make yourself available so that the grace gift that God has given you, it can be added to the body, and that's what makes the body stronger. That's what he's pointing to here. His life brought increase to and for the body and brought pleasure to the Father. His sacrifice, it brought increase, yes, and brought pleasure to the Father. Now, Jesus always did what the Father asked him to do. There's where the pleasure of God is. He obeyed the Father. And Jesus, in his obedience, because how that God had gifted him, Jesus was God's gift to us, the church. And now, you and I have become gifts to the church. And the question is, out of my obedience, I can bring pleasure to God, but what does my disobedience bring? The displeasure of God. God's provision. Grace can be defined in an acrostic. God's riches at Christ's expense. We know that. God's riches he pours in us at Christ's expense. So we've looked at verses 1, 2, and 3 at our calling. But now look at our consecration in verse 3, Endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Our energy, our focus, our responsibility. Striving to keep the unity of the Spirit. So how do you do that? Go back to verse 2. with all lowliness and gentleness, with long-suffering, bearing with one another in love. And then if you turn over to chapter 4, look in verses 29 through 32. This is what endeavoring looks like. One man said that these are the ligaments that hold the body together. Now, if you've ever torn a ligament or strained one, you know how painful that is. But these ligaments, I've already mentioned in verse 2, lowliness, gentleness, long-suffering, bearing with one another in love. Look in verse 29. Let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that means building up, that it may impart what? Grace to the hearers. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. And let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another. Oh, here it is. Even as God in Christ forgave you. That's our motivation. So when you talk about our consecration, you say, well, man, David, I mean, this is a lot of work. Yeah, that's being filled with the Spirit of God and allowing God to do all of these things in and through and with your life, so that when you speak to one another, you can do it with grace. Should not grace come out of our lives? We've been saved by grace. We have been given a grace gift. So you would think that it should be grace coming out of us. Not just a beautiful, rounded grape, but a grape that when it's squeezed, it gives forth what? Grace. Grace. Now back to chapter 4, verse 11. God has given the church these gifts. Apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastor, teacher. Now, we're not going to go into what all of those are. You know what they are. We've looked at it before. But their job descriptions are there for one thing and one thing only, to equip and build up the body, to strengthen the body. Now, look in verse 12. Here are the goals of the church. These have been given, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, for the equipping of the saints for the work of the ministry. The word equipping is a picture of a ship being refitted. In other words, it's been out, now it comes in, and it's time to go into dry dock, and they completely refit the whole ship. That's what the word equipping. In other words, the church is not supposed to just stay, boom, right there. This is what we do. We've always done it this way. We're not going to change, and it just sits right there. But the church needs to be refitted. The church needs to be what? It needs to be equipped. Equipping, it's called maintenance. It's ongoing. It never stops. It never stops. For the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body. Notice the order. Equipping comes first. Then you have the work of the ministry. And then, what's the work of the ministry? The work of the ministry is to edify the body of Christ. Why do we have church? We want to build up the church. We want to grow the church. We want to edify the church. And you say, well, the word edify sounds, well, it's an old term, but it means to make the church strong, to build it up. Working together to glorify God always edifies the Lord Jesus Christ. The process will continue. How long? We'll look in verse 13. Till we all come to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, to a mature, perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. In other words, the church will continue to be refitted. The church will continue to be equipped. The church will continue to be edified. We have to continue to do this. And who's the responsibility? Well, it's the apostles and the prophets, the evangelists and the teachers and pastors. And so we continue to do this until we look like Jesus. And when the church looks like Jesus, the world's going to take notice. Now, the Satan's going to take notice too. But the world's going to take notice. And that's the answer. John 3. Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto myself. If the church is not lifting up Jesus and all it's lifting up is programs, the church is not lifting up Jesus and all of it's lifting up is the personality of the pastor. If the church is not lifting up Jesus, guess what? It's all in vain. It's meaningless. There's no eternal value whatsoever with that. The process will continue until Jesus comes. Now watch verse 14. that we should no longer be children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the trickery of men and the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting. What concerns me is the church at large. Ladies and gentlemen, if we get away from teaching doctrine, we get away from teaching the Word of God, when we do that, then the church is going to continue to act childish, and everything that comes down the pike, literally, is going to sway the church and take it further and further away from its biblical mandate. Knowledge. Go back to verse 13. Till we all come to the unity of faith and the knowledge of the Son of God. Doctrine keeps us straight with each other and keeps us strong against the world. Verse 14, he talks about wind of doctrine. These are false teachers. They're nothing more than hot air. This is Paul. The trickery of men. He's talking about sleight of hand. Cunning craftiness. He's talking about these gamblers and bluffers. I mean, they all this emotion-driven stuff. It's subjective. It's not the objective truth of God that we need. And then it ends up in verse 14, the deceitful plotting, hiding behind the mask of piety and false security. It's out there. It's all over the place. Someone asked me some time ago, they said, well, how is it that the people who are really preaching and teaching the truth, how is it that they can't seem to find a platform on the national world stage? I said, well, it's probably money. So, well, how do all those guys get the money? And he just answered his question. I said, because Satan will put that out there and fund it, because that's not the truth. But the truth is what? Offensive. Did you understand? I'm going to be kind of silly here. Is the cross offensive? Yeah. Why? Well, you're talking about somebody dying. Why did he have to die? You know these connect. Because he paid our sin debt. Oh, so who are the sinners? Everyone. And what happens if you don't accept Christ as your Savior? Then you have to pay your own sin debt. And that's offensive to a world who struggles with truth. Struggles with truth. Now watch verse 15. But we're not to be tossed around like children, but we need to speak the truth in love. Adults. And we may grow up in all things to adulthood, and to him who is the head, Christ. Christ. Now watch verse 17. We're going to come back to 16. Paul says, this I say, therefore, and testify in the Lord, that you should no longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles walk, in the futility of their mind. Now, when you read this, I'm reading out of New King James this morning. What does it mean to walk like a Gentile? That means an unbeliever who walk about, the last phrase, in the futility of their mind. Corinthians, it talks about that the God of this age, who's Satan, he wants to blind the minds of people lest they see the glorious light of the gospel, and it should shine unto them that Jesus is Lord. So what's the battle for today? You know, we used to say it's a battle for the hearts. It's more like a battle for the mind. Because Satan can so just twist things, and you go back to the Garden of Eden. It's been going on for 6,000 years. You know, Satan came and tempted Eve and says, I want you to look at the fruit. Oh, it's good to look at. Oh, I bet it tastes good. And all this, it's subjective, and the next thing you know, she takes a bite out of it. Because he said, yea, he says, if you eat this, you'll be as God is. I mean, everybody needs knowledge. But she forgot the judgment factor. That's in chapter 3 of Genesis. The judgment factor is in chapter 2. And what did he say in chapter 2, verse 17? The day that you eat of this tree, he says, you will die. You will die. You will not be smarter. You will not be wiser. You will die. And what he was talking about, he's talking about physical death? Eventually, yes. But he's talking about spiritual death. Their fellowship with God would be broken. And that's what happened in the garden. Now, if that happened in the garden with Adam and Eve, what has Almighty God been doing since the Garden of Eden? He has been doing everything he can to make a way so that we could get back in fellowship with God. And because man could not do it on his own because he has a fallen nature, God came down in the flesh in the form of Jesus, and he made a way so that we could regain what was lost in the garden. That's why redemption is so important. That's why it's all grace. That's why the gospel message is so powerful. You see, the world, they're kind of stuck here. Well, it's all over with. God doesn't like me. He doesn't want me. He doesn't need me. He doesn't care about me. That's not true. If you look at the gospel story, you look at the history of the gospel, and you see the passion and the love of Almighty God for you, and how that God doesn't want to give up on you. God loves you, and he wants to redeem you. He pays your sin debt. He came and died in the flesh. He gave his own life on the cross so that the last enemy could be defeated, called death, in the resurrection. And you say that God doesn't love you? Where do you see that? Get out of the Garden of Eden and get to the Garden of Gethsemane. And you see him praying for you, weeping over you, asking the Father to help him obey so he could go to the cross. Jesus had never been separated from his Father, never. And when he went to the cross, he who knew no sin became sin. And it was such a horrific time, the heavens blacked out. There was an eclipse when Jesus was on the cross. It's almost as if God turned his back on Jesus because the wrath of God was falling upon sin. That's what sin, that's the judgment of sin. And then came Sunday morning, the resurrection. The enemy had been defeated. The sin debt had been paid in full. Paid in full. So, church, let's close. So, David, I know I've been saved, and I have a grace gift, you know, and I'm not maybe really sure what it is. But I mean, you know, you don't need me. You don't need me. Every member is important. 1 Corinthians 12, and we won't turn there, but it gives us, it talks about the body parts. Is the ear important to the body? It's a small thing. How about your little toe? Is that important to the body? Well, it is if you want to have balance. What about the nose? Is not a big deal. See, we think arms, legs, you know, that's important because that's the big stuff. Every piece of the body is important. That's why God made us that way. Let me ask you this question. Did the widow's mite count? Jesus took notice of it. It meant something to him. What did he say? He said, well, everybody else is putting in what they can afford. She's put in her all. But it was just a widow's mite. Joseph of Arimathea, he supplied the tomb for Jesus. Mary, the mother, gave birth to the child Jesus. The other Marys wrapped the corpse in spices. Phoebe carried the letter of Romans to the Romans. While Joshua fought the battle, Moses was up on the mountaintop praying. Well, no, what was going on was down in the valley. No, what was going on was happening on the mountaintop. So prayer warriors, you're more than needed. You're more than necessary. The church stands on your shoulders. You say, well, what about, you know, folks, listen, we can do all the whatabouts, and we say, well, Brother David, no, listen. God doesn't need me here. What he needs is church to be the church so that whoever stands here can do what they're supposed to do to teach the flock. See, we've got to get the personality out of it. Well, you know, Paul and Peter and John, you know, those were just men that God used. But Jesus was necessary. By God's grace, he has saved us. By God's grace, he has given us to the church as a gift. Let me close with this. Philippians chapter 1, verse 20. Just turn over a few pages. Philippians chapter 1, verse 20. Paul is giving, this is one of his farewell letters. He's in prison. We'll start in verse 19. For I know that this will turn out for my deliverance through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ. According to my earnest expectation and hope, listen, that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but with all boldness as always, so also Christ will be magnified in my body, whether by life or by death. Look at that phrase, so now Christ also will be magnified in my body. See, that goes back to Ephesians 4. That Christ, that you can see his grace in me, you can see his grace gift in me, and that you will see Christ's likeness in my life. And when the church, as individuals, when we come together, church, and we see that, that it's not like, okay, I've got to be Christ-like today. No. Christ's likeness. I mean, that's who we are. That's what we are. And then when we come together and we're being knitted and welded together and compacted, what an incredible picture of the Lord Jesus Christ. Not only can we enjoy that and minister to one another, but what a picture for the world to see. When they come in those doors, they see it. You know, when people visit here, because I got a great picture. I stand up here, I watch everybody comes in. And, you know, they come in, they don't come and say, wow, this is a nice looking sanctuary. No, they're looking at us. They're seeing how we treat one another, seeing how you know, do they get along or they just go along. They're watching everything that we do, everything that we do. So the question is, where do I fit? God has placed you here, or he would not have put you here. I heard a preacher years ago when I was in Bible college. He came in, he had a 15-minute sermon, and he said it all in the first thing that came out of his mouth. They introduced him. He got up there, and he says, simple. Go where you're sent. Stay put. Use what you got. Amen. That was a powerful sermon. Who's he preaching to? A bunch of preacher boys. We're all sitting there and say, you know, one day Charles Stanley's going to have to retire. You know, one day, you know, and you just see them out there, and man, they're daydreaming. You know, I was just scared to death to even be in there anyway. But I heard what he said. Go where you're sent. Stay put. Use what you got. Are you using terrible English? I know this. Are you using what you got? Are you? You got all these opportunities. And we're going to leave them up another week just to torment you. I watch you when you come in, you say, don't go over there, don't go over there. I'm going to sit. This is my seat. I'm sitting right here. Next week I want you guys over here and you guys over there. I can't go over there, preacher. You're going to get your hook in me. That's not my hook. Jesus wants to use you. Why? Because you're valuable. You're valuable. Every person is valuable. Every stinking one of us are valuable. Well, I don't know about that. Yeah. We are. Why did he save you? Old preacher said this. What's the first three letters of Satan? Sat. What's the first two letters of God? Go. Are you sitting or are you going? Who are you listening to? Amen? Let's pray. Father, I pray, Lord, today that I have done what you have sent me here to do. I pray that I've said the things that needed to be said. I pray, Lord, that you forgive me for the things that I may have misrepresented you with, or I may have miscommunicated. Now, Lord, I pray the Spirit of God would take the Word of God and find its way into all of our hearts and give us no rest until we are where you need us to be and you want us to be. Every one of us has value in the kingdom. And that value came from the price that Jesus paid so that we could have salvation. He died so we could live. He died so that we could become a part of His body. It's called the church. Am I fulfilling that which He has called me to? Salvation, yes. But He's also called me to a place of service, and He's given me a grace gift. Am I using it for His honor and for His glory, not mine? Spirit of God, speak to our hearts. In Your name I pray. Amen.